I'm just going to start with where I started. Fairfield shipyards, and I have really strong memories of, especially on a Friday afternoon when all, and it was many men, came pouring out of those shipyards through the big gate, and I would stand and watch them, hundreds, probably thousands of men. My father was really passionate about music, but not classical music. He was a big fan of country and western, and people like Jim Reeves, Hank Williams, Patsy Cline. He would listen to those all the time. Frank Sinatra as well, he was a big, big fan of. We had an old record player and we used to play these old 45s. And he got wind of the fact that I was able to choose these records for him, which meant he didn't have to get out of his chair. And he could just say, change the selection. And I think that actually sparked my very early ideas about program planning. I think it really, you know, just sowed a small seed for that. But actually, until I was 11, I hadn't heard one piece of classical music. And that came about when I went to school one day. I was about 11. And someone came into the class and said, who would like to play the violin? So I put up my hand, there were quite a few of us, but came back the next week and they said, we've got a problem here, we haven't got enough violins to give all of you, someone's going to have to play the cello. And this music teacher walked down the line and looked at all of our hands, and then he came back and he pointed at me and said, you're going to play the cello. Crazy school. It was a state school in quite a deprived area, but we did happen to have a fantastic music department with wonderfully dedicated music teachers. It's often the case, isn't it, that you, when you hear that, you only need one person to help you on your way, give you the introduction and look after you. And my music teacher, Winifred Dean, who was a saint, actually. I mean, when I started becoming more interested, I came into school early, before school started, about 7 o'clock, to practice, which was quite unusual in my area for people to do that sort of thing, and especially with classical music. And she said, if you come into practice early, I'll come in early and I'll bring you breakfast. She once, and this is a true story, she once came and dragged me off a football pitch when I should have been at the Royal Scottish Academy of Music doing an audition. And she came looking for me, and she literally dragged me. I remember her grabbing me because I wouldn't come. And she took me off and she drove me home, and she said, put some clean clothes on. And then she drove me into town, and she took me to the Royal Scottish Academy, and she went in and she apologised for us being late, and delivered me to do this audition for a scholarship. And it really is true. I wouldn't be here now if it wasn't for her. But I had this friend, Andy Devins, who was a violinist, and he was crazy about new music. When I was just still getting used to Tchaikovsky and Telemann and composers like that, he was listening to Alban Berg, and he was obsessed with the violin concerto. And I remember when I was around 15, I used to go and, you know, spend the evening with them, and we would listen to the Alban Berg violin concerto over and over and over again, and completely enthused about it. And Andy really gave me the bug.
Amazing that it came through a friend your own age and not somebody older and not through school. It's led you to meet some amazing people, players and composers.
And when I was 17, I met my first living composer. His name was John Bevan Baker. And I met him because actually I met his daughter a couple of months before I met him. And his daughter Sarah is now my wife. But through her, I got to know John. And he was a wonderful man, sadly no longer with us. And he really sparked my enthusiasm for working with living composers. Wonderful cellist called Joan Dixon. Spent a couple of years with her, and then she said to me, "Will, you've worn me out. Because I started so late, I really practiced very hard to make up for lost time." And she said, "I'm sending you off to London to a new teacher." And she was so amazingly helpful to me. She found this new teacher, a wonderful new teacher, Anna Rose Fleming, who I went off to for a couple of years. And during that time, I was working with London Contemporary Dance Theatre. I remember maybe 70, 80 performances of Britain's Third Cello Suite with London Contemporary Dance, going around all these huge theatres in Britain. Bristol Hippodrome and Sadler's Wells, and I've worked with dancers all my career actually, and I hope I continue to do that because it really changes the whole dynamic of performing when you're working with a dancer. While I was still studying, I received a phone call from John Tunnell, who was the leader of the Scottish Chamber Orchestra, and he said, "We, Scottish Chamber Orchestra, are coming to London on Wednesday, and we're going to be playing a concert at the Queen Elizabeth Hall. And actually, we have a vacant principal cello job. Would you be interested in auditioning?" So I thought, okay, 4 days' notice. Yeah. So anyway, I went along on Wednesday and I played it, and it went well. And then they said, I remember John saying to me, "Would it be unfair for us? I know it's very short notice, but to ask you to play some Bach," you know, being still quite a rough young Glaswegian, I said, "Yeah, it would be unfair, but I'll do it anyway." So I played some Bach and I got the job, and a lot of wonderful things happened to me in my 10 years at the SCO. And one of them was I was given the opportunity during a concert that the orchestra was doing with Yehudi Menuhin to play a Bach solo cello suite for Rudolf Nureyev. And I thought, "Whoa, yeah, I'll do that." So I did this performance at the Usher Hall in Edinburgh during the Edinburgh Festival to a packed house. Very exciting evening and a very exciting day meeting Rudolf Nureyev and being on stage with him during a rehearsal, which I have to say didn't go quite as I was hoping it would go. I mean, I was there. He didn't show at the beginning. I was just sitting on an empty stage playing through my Bach. And then the great man appeared and he couldn't remember his choreography, let's say that. And he said to me, "I'm sorry about this, but just keep playing and I'll get there." Was just to play, keep playing. So I did, and he turned up, came on stage looking absolutely wonderful as he did, an amazing athletic figure. And he came on and he had a hat with a feather in it. That was his only prop. And he basically just did something completely different to what he'd been doing in the afternoon. It was an absolutely extraordinary evening, on one that you, if you want to play with a dancer, you can't really top that, I have to say. Really importantly for me in my career, as it happened, I met Sir Peter Maxwell Davis, a wonderful composer who had an associate composer at the time with the Scottish Chamber Orchestra, and he was invited to write a series of concertos for the orchestra, for the principal players. And they were known as the Strathclyde Concertos. And Strathclyde Concerto number 2 was for cello, which was for me. And running alongside the Strathclyde Concertos was an educational project that for each concerto, there was another new composer invited to take part in the educational project, and that person in my case was James McMillan. So I was in very exalted company with these two composers that I was involved with. I think at that point, when I met John Bevan Baker and Sir Peter Maxwell Davis, living composers, it made me really clear that there's got to be a way of us getting these people's music heard and appreciated. We've got a job to do to help people to understand that.
It's obvious where your passion for new music stems from, but this need to communicate it and communicate it in the right way is obviously what led to you creating Hebrides Ensemble.
Some of my favourite projects with Hebrides Ensemble have been working with composers, living composers, of course. I've already mentioned Sir Peter Maxwell Davis, and we did lots of performances of his music theatre work. And we were able to go to Orkney and to the festival there, the St. Magnus Festival. I had lots of memorable concerts there. We did the Jongleur de Notre Dame, which, you need a juggler for that. So we found a juggler, which was great. We also happened to find out that this juggler that we had invited to come and work with us was also a high wire walker. But we managed to find a way of incorporating both his skills into this performance of Le Jongleur. In the St. Magnus Cathedral, there are these huge, big, useful red sandstone pillars. So we managed to rig up this clothes line between two big pillars in the cathedral. There's a whole scene where there's lots of miracles take place during this. This guy gets up onto this rope and does a high wire walk during the performance. And I think it's one of the, talk about heart and mouth. That was one of the most amazing live experiences I've ever had.
So you talked earlier a bit about being like a DJ for your father with your 45s, the records. What's it like programming a season?
I suppose I've always tried to find a different route into the programme and present things in a way that will really interest people and draw them in the hope that the music that they are going to hear, and quite a lot of it will be unfamiliar, but what I've always tried to ensure is that the music is at the highest level and standard and really fantastic music. I know that's very much in the down to personal taste, but I think you can really invite people to drop their guard, perhaps, and really just trust you as a performer, and that you're going to deliver something that they'll be able to enjoy. And even if they can't enjoy it, which has always been my thing, even if you can't enjoy it, you can still tell people that you didn't enjoy it with some authority.
Again, I think something at the heart of Hebrides, the juxtaposition of the familiar and the unfamiliar, and offered in a way that somehow makes both of them mean something more. I'm thinking of that project, the Schubert project with Miao Miao, cabaret artist.
She's a very electrifying performer. And it was great to work on this wonderful music by Schubert and Schumann, put together by Reinbert de Leeuw, the Dutch composer. And she gave her real full rein to really get underneath. I think this is what Reinbert was trying to do, really get underneath that music. So when she's expressing regret or anger, she starts shouting. Whereas in Schumann, it's delivered maybe a little bit more forcefully, but not shouting and screaming and crying. And the effect really is quite extraordinary. I find it extremely emotional hearing that. Someone just giving their all and really projecting those moods and those feelings so strongly.
Thank you.
at college, I auditioned for ECYO, it was European Community Youth Orchestra. It was the first year of its formation. It was a very exciting new European venture that began my life in a European context, meeting European musicians. We had such a fantastic time. We worked with amazing conductors there. We even worked with Herbert von Karajan. I remember that was a big highlight. I remember we rehearsed in the French Alps in a place called Courchevel. And we I remember, I can see it now, we were standing by the side of the swimming pool, the whole orchestra, looking up to the sky because Karajan flew his own plane to the rehearsal, which was, they didn't do that in Govan too often. So in that orchestra in ECYO, we had such amazing memories with Claudio as well. And when it was time for us to leave, a whole group of us who'd been there for about 4 or 5 years said, we can't go back to not having this access to each other and playing together. We really want to stay together. So we, with the help of Claudio Abbado and a great man called Peter Redman, who is the chairman of the Chamber Orchestra of Europe, after 40 years, nearly 40 years, we celebrate our 40th next year, we formed the Chamber Orchestra of Europe, and it's never looked back. I'm still there. I'm going to end up finishing my whole career with that orchestra, which is really quite something.
That's extraordinary to chart a course like that from music college all the way through to, well, you'll never retire, Will, I know that, but...
With the conductors I've mentioned before, people like Claudio, I was studying him really closely. And I was fascinated, I became fascinated with the skills that he had. And he was an amazing conductor. He could make music just with his eyes, with his hands, just the way he was on stage. He had fantastic technique. And of course, I was really trying to unpick this and trying to find his secret. And in doing that, and with other great conductors that we work with, I was really beginning to, find this passion to conduct. I entered the Leeds Conductors Competition that year in '94, and I got to the final. I was a prize winner and a finalist, and that gave me huge confidence. Also made me realise what I had to learn and the work I had to do. I was working with a lot of youth orchestras, and we formed, almost like Chamber Orchestra of Europe actually, out of the National Youth Orchestra of Scotland, a chamber orchestra was formed called Camerata Scotland. And the then director of that invited me to be the first conductor of the first Camerata Scotland, so it was really, it was such an honour to do that. And we made a lovely recording of the Mozart Symphony that I'm still really happy with, which is not always the case many years later on. Professional orchestras, and I went back and conducted the Scottish Chamber Orchestra and with a lot of the professional orchestras in Scotland, and I started moving out of Scotland. It was a very exciting time to be have these two careers in parallel, playing cello and conducting. And of course, that then led into working with singers, and that led into working in opera, which is a huge passion of mine. I was doing a lot of work with young people, as I mentioned, and I was doing a lot at Edinburgh University, where Nigel Osborne was the Reid Professor of Music at the time. And because I was interested in doing new music, Nigel invited me to conduct one of his operas. He then asked me if I would like to come to Srebrenica and Vienna and conduct his piece called Differences in Demolition. The differences referred to the differences between people and ways of life, and the demolition referred to the physical demolition during the war raging in Sarajevo at the time, the demolition of the physical structure of the country and the demolition of the rights of people and their way of life. A very powerful piece, and to take it to the place that it was written about was really quite extraordinary. We spent an amazing week there. Theatre. It was freezing cold because they couldn't afford the coal to heat the building. Anyway, the piece unfolds. It basically tells the story of all the people who were sitting in that theatre. It's a very poignant, very touching, very powerful story. Thank you. piece of music that really made people understand what their tradition had been and how it had been demolished in front of them. And I think it gave them a way forward, actually, of how to heal. And that's very much what Nigel Osborne is all about. And we spent an amazing evening in a bar in Srebrenica during our rehearsal period, where Nigel brought his guitar along, and he played. He speaks their language. He played and sang their own folk songs to them. And one by one, everybody started joining in and singing. And by the end, everyone was singing and everyone was in tears. And it was a very, very poignant moment then, and a real feeling of solidarity. One of the singers there was called Nadine Benjamin, and Nadine runs her own opera company in London, and it's called Everybody Can, and she tries to really give opportunity to people. She's a wonderful person, and she introduced me to her company and asked me to come and conduct Verdi's Otello, and I didn't have to think very hard to say yes to that.
Rigo per noi.
acting career was when my chamber group, Hebrides Ensemble, was given the chance to perform at the BBC Proms. They wanted a performance of Stravinsky's Soldier's Tale in 2018. It was a centenary of the piece being written. People need to be touched by music. You need to really feel it. And when I say touched, you can feel music. You know, it really can, you know, can make the hairs in the back of your neck stand up. It can make you shiver. It really can touch you. And I think as performers, we've got to really push ourselves to the limit. And that's what makes our job so much more enjoyable and challenging as well.
I love that you apply that same thinking to new music, because the heart is often lacking in how we approach it. We think a lot about it, and there's a lot of intellect that goes into it, but to communicate it and to make it really worthwhile to listen to, it needs to be both.
Composers like James McMillan, for instance, as a young composer, He was not scared to write tunes and melodies. And everyone was telling, you know, this was at a time when we were, you know, if you think back to 50s and 60s with Boulez, Stockhausen, and all of these people that were really trying to take music off in a different direction. When people like Jimmy McMillan came along and started writing melodies and using, you know, very consonant harmony, and you know, people really, you know, the new music people didn't like that. That was too simplistic. But I think Jimmy was just following his instincts of trying to communicate with people, and there was plenty of you know, brutality in his music as well. But there's a lot of beauty, and it's interesting to me in that time, you know, in the last sort of 30, 40 years, the way that, that music that at one point was threatening to, or a certain branch of music was threatening to go off and not take very many people with it. There's a whole new generation of composers that are really working with audiences. I don't mean to just please them and just give them what they want. They're finding a way of keeping beauty very much at the heart of music, but it's the juxtaposition of that beauty, because this is another Harnoncourt thing. He said that beauty is found on the edge of chaos. We're 30 years old next year, at least. And of course, I'm thinking, you know, what have we done here, in particularly in Scotland, where we're based? What have we offered the public? What have we got to? What have we still got to offer? And what do we have as a legacy? And decided that we would do single composer portraits and really explore with the composer, and that's been the great thing, to have these living composers and talk to them about what they would like to be recorded well. And we've managed to do that with Sir James McMillan, Sir Peter Maxwell Davis, then we did work by Nigel Osborne, and we've done works by Judith Weir. Are enjoying and loving the music and really being inspired by composers taking us to areas that we haven't been, emotions that we haven't really discovered yet, combinations of emotions that they're dreaming up, because really we're all reinventing the wheel, let's face it. But there's so many different ways of doing that. It's just pure joy.
Scotland does seem to be a very fertile ground for all of these composers and these projects. What do you think makes it so conducive to that?
I would agree. Scotland's a wonderful place. I think a lot of people have a slightly nostalgic, romantic view of Scotland when they're thinking about the arts. And I think there are different opportunities in Scotland. And I think what we've, you know, we have Edinburgh Festival here, the International Festival, which was born out of the last disaster that we had after the war, with this incredible energy. And I really hope, and I feel optimistic that will kick in again after this present problem that we have. I think the energy of the arts is an incredibly powerful thing. So I think it will really rejuvenate all of us, and I'm particularly concerned for younger musicians and younger artists entering the profession or who have just started, because I feel incredibly lucky to have had the opportunities that I've had and been helped by so many influential people. And I just really hope that this generation that's waiting and has just joined us in the music profession, my real concern is for them, and I really hope that we can do, and I certainly will be doing my bit to try and, you know, give them a leg up, trying to really get back on this amazing track that we've all been on, and that we can really press forward. And there are things that will come out of this time, I'm sure, that will help us, that we've learned that we didn't know before, and that we can take forward and make the future better. I've been working with St Mary's Music School, which is a specialist music school in Scotland, and it's a really challenging job because these are really important things to get right for young people. And for me, it's really nice to be working with young musicians from the age of 9 upwards, right the way through until I meet them in youth orchestra, and then when I meet them in the profession. The thing is, I just love music. I love making music. I love working with other musicians. It's absolutely not a job for me. It's just really a way of life. It's my religion. It's everything for me. And that's really what drives me. I want people to listen to this vast repertoire that's available to us, and to get pleasure from it. What more can we ask for?